Tafsir of Surah Al-Baqarah. In the previous session, we mentioned the many bounties that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestowed upon the Israelites. And we mentioned that, you know, Bani Israel, nisbatan, in relation to Israel alayhi salam, which is Yaqub alayhi salam, has two names, Israel and Yaqub alayhi salam. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in these two ayat, يا بني إسرائيل اذكروا نعمتي التي أنعمت عليكم وأني فضلتكم على العالمين. All the children of the Israelites, or Bani Israel, remember my bounties upon you. التي أنعمت عليكم وأني فضلتكم على العالمين, and that I preferred you over the عالمين. And we mentioned last session that we're gonna save the issue of تفضيل, preferential, or selection or election of such a group of people for a separate session in order to cover this one, because we will see that in later ayat inshallah in Surah Al-Baqarah and other surah where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the tafdeel of Bani Israel. First and foremost, we believe as Muslims that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has the infinite knowledge and the infinite wisdom, and that any actions that emanate from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is according to a divine system of justice. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not prefer any person over another because of the color of their skin, or the length of their beard, or the color of their hair, or their height, or their physical appearance, or any of that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sets the record straight for us, where He says, إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ, that the most honorable among you in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are those who are most taqi, most righteous, most pious. So this is a general rule of thumb, a sunnah, a rule that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has set as a scale of justice, as a scale of fairness among all of His slaves. So the tafdeel that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned about Bani Israel is the fact that He sent them the prophets and the messengers, that He descended upon them the revelations, and that He made among them kings, as He tells us in the Qur'an, in one ayah, which we mentioned in the previous halaqah, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِذْ قَالَ مُوسَى لِقَوْمِهِ يَا قَوْمِ اذْكُرُوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ. When Moses, peace be unto him, mentioned to his people, he said, oh my people, mention or remember and appreciate the bounty and the bounties that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descended upon you, إِذْ جَعَلَ فِيكُمْ أَنْبِيَاءَ, that He has sent you prophets and messengers from, you know, Yaqub alayhi salam all the way to Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. وَجَعَلَكُمْ مُلُوكَ, and He had made kings among you. وَآتَاكُمْ مَا لَمْ يُؤْتِ أَحَدًا مِنَ الْعَالَمِينَ, and that He has bestowed upon you from bounties that which was specific to you. That which was specific to you. Because the bounties of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are upon all of His creation. They're not specific to a certain group of people or certain, you know, creation over another. Rather, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with His infinite system of justice, He bestows bounties upon His slaves according to His knowledge and wisdom. So this is just one ayah that mentions the bounties and the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala preferred the children of Israel, the Israelites, over other people by sending them the prophets and the messengers and making, you know, kings among them, and bestows bounties upon them in terms of the revelations and other bounties. Now, in this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning these bounties to the Israelites as a matter of criticism and blame. Why is that? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taken a covenant from the Israelites. As He tells us, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taken covenants from the Israelites, فَبِمَا نَقْضِهِمْ مِيثَاقَهُمْ, then they have deceived themselves and they have broken their covenants. وَكُفْرِهِمْ بِآيَاتِ اللَّهِ, and they disbelieve in the ayat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَقَتْلِهِمُ الْأَنْبِيَاءَ بِغَيْرِ حَقٍ, and they have killed many, many of their prophets and messengers. Some of the narrations tell us that at a given point Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was sending to them a prophet or a messenger every single day. Every single day. وَقَتْلِهِمُ الْأَنْبِيَاءَ بِغَيْرِ حَقٍ, وَقَوْلِهِمْ قُلُوبُنَا غُلْفٌ, and they would say that our hearts are sealed. And the word غُلْف has two different meanings. One of which meaning that our hearts have been sealed in such a way that no guidance, no knowledge can penetrate it. That's one interpretation. The other is that our hearts contain of the knowledge that which is sufficient make us sufficient from the need for the knowledge that any prophet or any messenger or any divine revelation has come with. And of course, both of these, you know, statements are wrong because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, بَلَّعَنَهُمُ اللَّهُ بِكُفْرِهِمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has cursed them. And the word al-la'na means al-tardu min al-rahmah, means the expulsion from the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَقَلِيلًا مَا يُؤْمِنُونَ means very few of them actually became believers. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, just to further explain this issue of tawdeel, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of course, undoubtedly, and according to the Quran and the Sunnah, has preferred this ummah over all other ummah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, كُنْتُمْ خَيْرَ أُمَّةٍ أُخْرِجَتْ لِلنَّاسِ تَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَتَنْهَوْنَ عَلِي الْمُنْكَرِ وَتُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ. You are the best nation ever put out to humanity. Why? So this tafdeel is not infinite. In other words, no one among us can come and say, I am among the best nation, so therefore I am the best of the best. No. One condition must exist. Is that تَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَتَنْهَوْنَ عَلِي الْمُنْكَرِ وَتُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ. Means that you have the right creed. You enjoin the good and you forbid the evil. And you follow the sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad. So this is a general selection. Another example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addresses the mothers or the believers among the most righteous women ever walked the face of the earth. And he says, يَا نِسَاءَ النَّبِيِّ لَسْتُنَّ كَأَحَدٍ مِنَ النِّسَاءِ. All spouses of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you are unlike any other woman. What is the condition? إِنْ اتَّقَيْتُنْ. إِنْ اتَّقَيْتُنْ. If you practice taqwa, if you practice righteousness. And then another ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warns them. يَا نِسَاءَ النَّبِيِّ مَنْ يَأْتِ مِنْكُنَّ بِفَاحِشَةٍ مُبَيِّنَةٍ يُضَاعَفْ لَهَا الْعَذَابِ. All spouses of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who among you ever comes with a fahisha? The fahisha is ma azma min al-dhanb, meaning that which is among the kabair. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says what? Yudha'afu laha al-adab. For her, there'll be twice the punishment. Why? Because they are unlike any other woman. They are unlike any other woman. Ya bani Israel, اذكروا ni'mati allati an'amtu alaykum wa anni faddaltukum 'ala al-'alamin. Now, this tafdeel, this preference that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to the Israelites, according to the majority of the scholars, was specific to their time. Why? Because it was prevalent in their time, you know, shirk, disbelief, atheism, so on and so forth, that was pretty prevalent. So they were the only people that were a people of a divine revelation. They were the only people at that time, from Yaqub alayhi salam all the way to Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, that they had divine revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So therefore, this is the preferential treatment that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to them. As for the others, they were upon true misguidance. Now, when Isa alayhi salam came and gone, and he came to also give the good news of the coming of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَبِمَا نَقْضِهِمْ مِيثَاقَهُمْ. What is the covenant that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taken from them? لَمَا أَتَيْتُكُمْ مِنْ كِتَابٍ وَحِكْمَةٍ لَتُؤْمِنُنَّ بِهِ. That whatever divine revelation, after the coming of Isa alayhi salam, that I bring to you, that's going to affirm and confirm that which is between your hands, whatever messenger, and here it refers to the seal messenger, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whatever messenger I send to you, which is clearly described in your revelation, that you will support him, you will believe in him, you will submit to him, and follow his commands and make him victorious over the disbelievers. And Mu'adh ibn Jabal and others, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came, they would talk to the Israelites. And they would say, weren't you telling us, this is before Islam came altogether, didn't you tell us about the description of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in your revelation? And didn't you tell us that he will come to make you victorious? And didn't you tell us that he will come to lead you to guidance and righteousness, so on and so forth? Why would you not believe in him now? They said, we never told you that. They said, we never said anything like that. And subhanAllah. Similarly, one of their ahbab, one of their scholars, who came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to embrace Islam, based on what he has seen in the Torah, that confirms that this is the Prophet, this is the sealed messenger from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When he came to embrace Islam and to give his covenant to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, O Prophet of Allah, I'm going to hide, you know, in a room. And the heads of my tribe is going to come to you. Before you invite them to Islam, tell them what do you think of so and so. So they came, their heads came, And before the Prophet ﷺ invited them to Islam, he said, what do you think of so-and-so, one of your scholars? He said, we think of him as an honorable person, as a truthful person, as a knowledgeable person, as a person true in his confidence that he would not lie, he has this good moral characters, good ethics, so on and so forth. Then the Prophet ﷺ said, come on out. So he came out, the man said, أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ وَأَشْهَدُ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا عَبْدُهُ وَرَسُولُهُ. They immediately after that said what? You know, he's one of our despicable people, we do not believe him any, he's not trustworthy, he's this, 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 and that. So this is the traits of such people. So with that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has removed this bounty from them and has replaced it with what? Punishment and curse. And as he tells us in the Quran and in the ayat that will come, that will follow these ayat, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, of course, in addition to their claims and their disbelief in the Prophet ﷺ and the revelation, the biggest and most hideous claim that they made against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where they said, وَقَالَتِ الْيَهُودُ يَدُ اللَّهِ مَغْلُودَةً. They said that the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are stingy. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, غُلَّتْ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَلُعِنُوا بِمَا قَالُوا. Their hands are stingy, and we see that in them up to this day. وَلُعِنُوا بِمَا قَالُوا. And they're cursed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by way of that they've said. By way of that they've said. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has written upon them the tea, that they will be lost in the desert of Sina for 40 years. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has, when they refuse to submit to what Moses alayhi salam has come with, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِذْ نَتَقْنَا فَوْقَهُمُ الْجَبَلِ. Means that you're going to come to submission. Imagine, to bring a people to submission, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would raise a mountain above them, to the extent that they would tilt their necks, afraid of the mountain to collapse over them, in order to make their sujood, in order to make their ruku'ah. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has despised their creation, that they've turned them into pigs and monkeys. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent the sa'iqah upon them. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent, you know, a wind with fire from the sky upon them. And so on and so forth, and so on and so forth. Of course, there's many lessons for us to learn as Muslims. That yes, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen these people for a specific period of time. And He's bestowed His bounties upon them. And He has sent them the prophets and the messengers and the revelations in order to bring them closer to Him and to make them more righteous and more obedient, so on and so forth. However, when they turned away, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taken all of that from them. Similarly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created friction between them and enmity and disputes and hostility and so on and so forth. And fortunately or unfortunately, we see this among us now. That when our covenant and our commitment, you know, this is not something that we use just to talk about prior nations in order to purify ourselves, in order to raise ourselves. No, the rule applies to us just like it applies to them. And the scholars say that those who turn away from the Quran and the Sunnah are in a worse position than the Israelites, are in a worse position than the people of the book at large. Okay? So their claim that they are the God-chosen people is a false claim, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answered that in many places in the Quran. And He says, وَقَالَتِ الْيَهُودُ وَالنَّصَارَى نَحْنُ أَبْنَاءُ اللَّهِ وَأَحِبَّاءُ. That the Jews and the Christians, we say, we are the children of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the ones who are loved among all humanity to Him. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ فَلِمَ يُعَذِّبُكُمْ بِذُنُوبِكُمْ. So why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala punish you with your sins? Notice the system of justice here. There's no retaliation. There's no vengeance. None of that, وَعِيَادُ بِاللَّهِ. قُلْ فَلِمَ يُعَذِّبُكُمْ بِذُنُوبِكُمْ. Why does He punish you by way of that which you've earned in terms of sinful behavior and sins? بَلْ أَنْتُمْ. Indeed, you are a creation just like all the other creation that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created. And you are held up to the same standards that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with His infinite justice and wisdom, has held all of mankind. So this is something for us to take heed in. The fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen this ummah, the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, perhaps is an honor because of the fact that the best of prophets is from this ummah. That we ought to hold our covenants to a higher standard with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have to be more keen about following the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We have to be more concerned about understanding the Qur'an, believing in it, reciting the Qur'an, and applying it to the best of our abilities in order for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to honor his, you know, covenant to us. In other words, it's reciprocal. We have to honor ours in order for him to fulfill his covenant to us. Then in the second ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds us and reminds them as well, وَاتَّقُوا يَوْمًا لَا تَجْزِي نَفْسٌ عَنْ نَفْسٍ شَيْئًا وَلَا يُقْبَلُ مِنْهَا شَفَاعَةٌ وَلَا يُؤْخَذُ مِنْهَا عَدْلٌ وَلَا هُمْ يُنْصَرُونَ. And fear a day, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is always directing our attention and everybody's attention to that day where the justice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has absolutely no preferential treatment. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to tell the Sahaba, he said, I don't want people to come to me with their deeds and their belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you come to me with the fact that we're friends in this dunya. He said, I will not accept that from you. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would tell Aisha, you know, his dearest person to him among his spouses, after Khadija radiallahu anhu wa Allahum jami'a, he tells her, اعملي يا عائشة فإني لا أغني عنك من الله شيء. He said, do your deeds. Believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, submit to him, and practice righteousness, and do your deeds. فإني لا أغني عنك من الله شيء. I cannot intercede on your behalf in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unless he approves of your deeds first. اعملي يا فاطمة. You know, the daughter of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, closest to his heart, among his children. He said, perform your deeds. فَإِنِّي لَا أُغْنِي عَنْكِ مِنَ اللَّهِ شَيْءٍ. I cannot perform intercession or intercede on your behalf in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unless and until he approves of your deeds. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reminding everybody, وَاتَّقُوا يَوْمًا تُرْجَعُونَ فِيهِ إِلَى اللَّهِ. Meaning that, وَاتَّقُوا يَوْمًا لَا تَجْزِي نَفْسٌ عَنْ نَفْسٍ شَيْءًا. That no soul shall bear the sins of another. No soul can ransom, you know, one another. وَلَا يُؤْخَذُ مِنْهَا شَفَاعَةً. No one can intercede on behalf of another person, be it a prophet, or a messenger, or a martyr, or a close one, or a righteous, or a siddiq, or any of that, without the approval of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As he says, مَنْ الَّذِي يَشْفَعُ عِنْدَهُ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِهِ. Who's going to intercede in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala except with his permission? And in Surah Al-Isra, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also reminds us by saying, in Surah Taha, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds us by saying, وَلَا يُخَذُ مِنْهَا شَفَاعَةً, means that no soul can be permitted to intercede on behalf of another soul without the approval and the consent of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَخَشَعَتِ الْأَصْوَاتُ لِلرَّحْمَنِ فَلَا تَسْمَعُ إِلَّا هَمْسَةً. Not even is allowed to speak, let alone intercede, without the approval and the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَا يُقْبَلُ مِنْهَا شَفَاعَةً وَلَا يُؤْخَذُ مِنْهَا عَدْلٌ. Adl here means no adl will be accepted from it, no ransom will be accepted from it. Yani even if the kafir, يَوَدُّ الْمُجْرِمُ لَوْ يَفْتَدِي مِنْ عَذَابِ يَوْمِئِذٍ بِأَخِيهِ وَصَاحِبَتِهِ وَبَنِيهِ وَفَصِيلَتِهِ الَّتِي تُؤْوِي وَمَنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ جَمِيعًا ثُمَّ يُنْجِيهِ كَلَّا. That the criminal, the disbeliever, the mushrik, the kafir, the munafiq, would wish that they can ransom themselves with all that on the face of the earth, with their dearest person to them, with their brother, with their sister, with their mother, with their parents, with their children, everybody on the face of the earth, but they will not be accepted from them. So whatever fidya, whatever ransom one offers to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it shall not be accepted from them. So if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala severs any hope whatsoever of us attaching ourselves to, you know, material wealth, to status, to family members, to people of righteousness, people of lack of righteousness, waliyadu billah, he's telling us, come to me, attach yourself to me, nobody else. Because none can rule on judgment day but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. None has the decree on judgment day but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. None owns Jannah, none owns the hellfire except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَا يُؤْخَذُ مِنْهَا عَدْلٌ وَلَا هُمْ يُنْصَرُونَ. And no benefit whatsoever can be materialized from anybody aside from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أقول قولي هذا واستغفروه. اللهم اهدنا فيمن هديت وعافنا فيمن عافيت وتولنا فيمن توليت وبارك اللهم لنا فيما أعطيت وقنا واصرف عنا اللهم برحمتك شر ما قضيت. اللهم اسألك الرضاء بعد القضاء وبرد الحياة بعد الممات والنظر إلى وجهك الكريم في غير ضراء مضرة ولا فتنة مضلة إنك ولي ذلك والقادر عليه سبحانك اللهم بحمدك نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين جزاكم الله خيرا في الكامل السلام عليكم.